What if I told you that you had what can be called a second brain? And that this second brain was actually down in your belly? And that it isn't controlled by you per se, but by trillions and trillions of tiny living organisms? It almost sounds made up, doesn't it? But in actual fact, that so-called second brain is your gut, and it is part of an important biological phenomenon called the gut-brain axis, which is what I am very excited to be talking to you about today. So what is the gut-brain axis? This is a term used to describe the communication between our gut and our brain. These two critical organs talk to each other in a variety of ways, but one of these is via the vagus nerve. The vagus nerve is one of the longest nerves in the body and connects the brain to the digestive tract, sending signals in both directions. Essentially, this means that our brain can, of course, influence our gut, but our gut can also influence our brain, including things such as our mood. Another major player in the gut-brain axis is our gut microbiota. These are the trillions of tiny living organisms I said earlier are running the show in our digestive tract. Our gut microbes have been proven to be important in regulating our health and possibly even contributing to our risk of developing certain diseases. When we have a good balance and a high diversity of these microbes, they contribute positively to our health. Just like having lots of different plants, animals, insects, and wildlife in a garden is necessary for the ecosystem to thrive. However, when the microbes become imbalanced and those bad microbes take over, this can impact negatively on our well-being and lead to things like increased inflammation and even increased risk of diseases like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, heart disease, anxiety, and depression, amongst others. So we know that our microbes are important, but what role specifically do they play in this gut-brain axis? Well, microbes can actually influence the brain in a few ways, but one of these is that they produce tiny little molecules that can either travel to the brain in the bloodstream or stimulate that vagus nerve, both of which result in influencing brain activity. It's therefore important that we focus on our gut microbiota as key controllers of the gut-brain axis. But I suppose the most important question of this talk is, why is the gut-brain axis actually important, and what role does it play in our health? Before I attempt to answer that, I should note that this area of research is relatively new, and there's a lot more work that needs to be done. While changes in gut microbiota have been linked with health conditions, it's yet to be completely confirmed as to whether these changes are contributing to the development of disease or are a result of the disease itself. However, there are lots of promising studies that have been done and are being done to address this question. And in my talk, I'm going to go through a few examples of what we currently know based on the research. I'll start by talking about an issue that is unfortunately common in our world today, and that's mental health. Of course, multiple factors influence and contribute to mental health conditions, but one of these could be the gut-brain axis. Patients with depression have been shown to have a changed gut microbiota composition compared to healthy controls. One study actually took gut microbiota samples from patients with depression and transferred them to rats that had no gut microbiota of their own. What they saw when they did this was that the rats actually developed their own anxiety and depression-like symptoms, suggesting that a person's gut microbiota could play a role in the development of depression. The gut-brain axis has also been linked with Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's is what we call a neurodegenerative disease, which is where neurons, the cells in our brain, gradually die, causing the symptoms. Originally, Parkinson's research solely focused on the brain, until a theory emerged that Parkinson's might actually begin in the gut and spread to the brain via the vagus nerve. When scientists looked into it, they found that there is actually evidence to support this as a route of disease development. They found that Parkinson's patients had a different gut microbiota composition compared to healthy controls. And they also took samples from these patients and transferred them to mice. Unsurprisingly, the mice developed their own Parkinson's symptoms, and more than this, these were reversed when the gut microbiota were wiped out with antibiotics. This illustrates that our gut microbiota and the gut-brain axis could play an important role in the development of neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's. But it's not just our gut that can affect our brain health. Our brain can affect our gut health as well. For example, in irritable bowel syndrome, otherwise known as IBS. This is a common condition which causes pain, altered bowel movements, and other uncomfortable digestive symptoms. It's actually known as a gut-brain axis disorder, which means it's highly affected by inputs from the brain and the nervous system. Patients report that their symptoms actually get worse in response to stress, which makes sense because we know that stress actually impacts how the gut works, including how it moves and the diversity of the microbes it has. So this is yet another example of just how important the gut-brain axis can be in our health. So I've talked a bit about what the gut-brain axis does for us, but what does the research say that we can do for it to help support it and keep it working optimally? Well, the good news is that our gut microbiota are very dynamic and are affected by lots of different factors. Some of these we don't have control over, like our genes or how we were delivered at birth. However, there are some that we do have control over, like our diet, our exercise, and how we manage our stress. In fact, diet has been shown as one of the most important and the most influential factors affecting those gut microbes, and is therefore an important thing to focus on when aiming to improve gut health and hence gut-brain axis health. Research has shown that the diversity and the composition of our gut microbiota can be changed quickly in response to what we feed it. One study looked at switching from an animal-based diet to a plant-based diet and vice versa. And what they saw was that the composition of the gut microbiota changed in as little as 24 hours as a result. What we feed those microbes also counts. Those on a Western diet, that's a diet high in fat, salt, and sugar, have been shown to have negative changes to their gut microbiota. Whereas those on a Mediterranean diet, a diet high in whole grains, nuts, beans, fruits, and vegetables, have positive changes to their gut microbiota with a higher diversity and more of those good gut microbes present. The amount of plant foods we include is also important. The American Gut Project showed that people eating 30 or more different plant foods a week had a higher diversity of microbes and more good gut bacteria compared to people eating 10 or less. Some of you may also have heard of probiotics. These are alive, beneficial gut bacteria. Think of them sort of like seeds planted in a garden that when they grow and flourish, benefit the entire ecosystem. The idea is that probiotics benefit the ecosystem of the gut and help it to stay balanced. And they're found in fermented foods like yogurt, kimchi, kefir, and sauerkraut. Prebiotics are also important for gut health. Not to be confused with probiotics, prebiotics are like a food for our gut microbes. They need these to survive and thrive. And they're found in things like onions, asparagus, leeks, bananas, and oats. On to some non-diet factors that can help support the gut-brain axis. We know that exercise, specifically moderate levels of exercise, so this is swimming, jogging, cycling, walking, and even dancing, can increase the diversity and the amount of good gut microbes that we have. And finally, stress. As I briefly mentioned, we know stress impacts gut health. Multiple animal studies and some human studies have shown that stress can actually change the composition and the diversity of our gut microbiota. And therefore, managing our stress is important for taking care of our gut-brain axis, which I know is much easier said than done, but the research states it. So I appreciate that I've thrown a bunch of research at you there. And as I said earlier, there's a lot more work to be done here, particularly more human studies are needed. This is necessary for us to fully grasp and understand all the gut-brain axis can do and all that it contributes to. However, I hope I have somewhat conveyed the intricacy and complexity of this part of our biology. The gut-brain axis is an incredible system of feedback and communication, so interlinked that our gut and its microbes can go as far as to influence things like our mood and our cognition, which I think is pretty amazing. So to look after our brains, we have to look after those tiny gut microbes too. They do more for us than we can even know. And with that, thank you so much for listening.